We're going to move on now to our next item of business, and I'm going to hand over the chair to Lewis MacDonald as presiding officer. Donald.
Thank you very much. The next item of business is a member's business debate on motion 23448 in the name of Linda Fabiani on Young Women Lead Report on how to increase employment opportunities for black and minority ethnic women. This debate will be concluded without any questions being put. Can I ask those members who wish to speak in the debate please to put an R in the chat box, and I call on Linda Fabiani to open the debate.
Thank you very much, Presiding Officer. I'm really pleased to be able to shine a light on the work I've been privileged to participate in on behalf of our Parliament with Young Women Lead. It's a leadership programme for women aged 30 and under who live in Scotland, delivered in partnership with the YWCA Scotland, the Young Women's Movement. This is the third of the subject programmes I've been involved in, and by way of quick explanation, part of the leadership programme is that the participants form a committee, chaired by me, which carries out an inquiry on a subject of their choosing in the format of a formal parliamentary committee. Chosen topic of inquiry this year, investigating education and employment and that important transition for young women from ethnic minorities is one of real importance to this year's participants. For the first time, young women from ethnic minority backgrounds have made up the whole committee membership. It's a sobering fact that there has never been a woman from an ethnic minority elected to the Scottish Parliament. And I know that members of this Parliament firmly believe that this must change. It's appropriate at this point to note that the Young Women Lead Committee, in their report, acknowledge the problematic nature of the use of the term BAME. The term features extensively in the report in order to represent the demographic of the committee and its inquiry focus, for lack of what they feel could be a better word available in the current landscape. Over the course of the inquiry, the participants heard of the challenges and barriers faced by young women from ethnic minorities in education, in job hunting, in employment. Of course, we've all heard about this for some time. We all know there's an issue. What our young women also heard and determined is that what is needed is focus on finding solutions, focus on truly sharing best practice and creating real change. There has to be improvement. The recommendations contained in the report are a step towards that change. As I say in the introduction to the Young Women Lead 2019-20 report, this report is the voice of the young women on this year's committee, and now is the time for that voice to be heard. The report details background and current policy. It talks about education, about employment, and as I said, that very important transition between them. The report notes that there are many policy initiatives in the public sphere. It notes that there are ambitious aims and good intentions. However, the barriers still exist. Out with the work of Young Women Lead, this is indeed an issue that has exercised many of us for some time. Too often we tick the boxes, but we don't open them up for qualitative assessment. If the Minister will excuse my saying, governments, both national and local, are often guilty of this. The report makes specific recommendations in the education sphere to ensure that local authorities recruit BAME-identifying individuals as career advisors and invest in useful training and development for all career advisors. Create a career development programme linking BAME women to resources where they can build a career pathway. Acknowledge the importance of role models and create mentorship schemes for young BAME women. And further consider the presentation of opportunities at local authority career events and school fairs. When it comes to employment, there is an understandable load in the recommendations, but I will focus today on those that we believe can be considered by the Scottish Government for action by themselves or for discussion with partners in the public and private sectors. Ensure employers collect and use workforce data to benchmark current levels of BAME women within their workplace to identify underrepresented population. There is a lack of Scotland-specific data. Support proactive recruitment strategies, scholarship programmes, internships, apprenticeships, work experience, again for these underrepresented populations. Support the creation of BAME networks and sectors of industry and look at creating a stakeholder group of appropriate people to develop a portal of best practice for employers. And highlight and celebrate employers with the best policies to support and develop young BAME women. And directly for the Scottish Government, evaluate the effectiveness of the existing toolkit surrounding recruitment practices and consider expansion beyond just the recruitment process. Fund third sector organisations who already provide recruitment services and allow them to specialise in this area. A major recommendation that covers both elements of the study is to acknowledge the additional barrier of poverty, which can disproportionately affect BAME communities' experience. You can do this by Scottish Government funding of BAME-led organisations, lead organisations that deliver employability support. And on this is an additional and personal comment from me. What's needed is sustainable funding for organisations that have shown they're effective. Funding which allows them to get on with the job rather than constantly seeking and justifying further financial support. I am, Presiding Officer, looking forward to the Minister. He and his colleagues, particularly Christina McKelvey, the Equalities Minister, will be aware that the general findings of the Young Women Committee complement the findings of other studies. Close the Gap is a much respected policy advocacy organisation working on women's labour market participation. They have welcomed the Young Women Lead report and they note that, to quote, in Scotland, Black and minority ethnic women face an intertwined set of gendered and racial barriers that affect their ability to enter, progress and stay in good quality employment. What the Minister and his colleagues, and indeed yourself, Presiding Officer, may not know is the further interest that this report and the work of our Parliament and the Young Women's Movement has invoked. Already, participants of the Young Women League Committee, along with Elena Soper from the Young Women's Movement and Hayley Forrester from our own clerking team, and myself, of course, have met with the parliaments of Bavaria, Catalonia, Wales and Flanders to discuss the programme and the report. And next week, we've been invited to discuss with the chair of the Circle of Women Parliamentarians at the National Assembly of Quebec. I hasten to add this has been all online, Presiding Officer. I don't have time this evening to thank everyone who has taken part in this project. Those, for example, who met with participants, giving of their time and providing evidence. Particular mention must go, though, to the dedicated staff of the Young Women's Movement and to our own parliamentary staff who helped to develop the Young Women League project and have enthusiastically embraced it over the past 3 years. Of course, there are the young women who have taken part. I don't have the words, let alone the time, to express the admiration I have for them and the work they have carried out through the hardest of times. The dedication they have shown and the determination to make a difference to the lives of other young women living in Scotland has been truly inspirational. We all believe it is time for change. We believe that change is possible. This report is valuable and I commend it to Parliament. I recommend it to the Scottish Government as extremely useful information to be considered very seriously. Thank you, Presiding Officer.
Thank you very much. And I now call on Ruth Maguire to be followed by Rachel Hamilton.
Presiding Officer, I'd like to start by congratulating Linda Fabiani on securing this debate and indeed acknowledge the excellent support she's given to this important and interesting project. I want to commend the Young Women Lead Committee themselves on their work, work that they've done in, as Linda said, in particularly challenging times. BAME women are underrepresented in all sectors of the labour market, and I agree with this report that it must change to better reflect Scottish society. This should not be news to any of us in this chamber. Over the last two decades, there have been numerous parliamentary committee reports, academic research, government race equality frameworks supported by action plans, all aimed at tackling institutional racism and improving equality for minority ethnic people. And while there has been some progress, the Young Women Lead Committee report highlights how slow that's been and the inordinate amount of work still to be done. I was deeply troubled to read in the report that 65% of respondents to the inquiry aged 25 to 30 were actively discouraged by school career counsellors from pursuing specific paths. I would express concern that although career guidance is available, it is often infrequent and inconsistent, and I welcome and support the recommendation for local authorities to recruit BAME-identifying individuals as career advisors. This is a really important recommendation, as all the recommendations are, and they should be actioned. I want to be clear this afternoon, though, that responsibility for the employment gap does not lie with underrepresented individuals, and much more must be done to tackle institutional racism. The Equalities and Human Rights Committee, which I convened last year, reported on race equality, employment and skills. The report looked at the recruitment process of public authorities and showed that according to the regional employment patterns in Scotland, the employment gap between BAME workers and white workers was 14.4%, and this rose to 16.4% in 2019. In opening, Linda mentioned Close the Gap. Their research paper, still not visible, research on Black and minority ethnic women's experiences of employment in Scotland, was published in February 2019. They reported that many minority ethnic women face a range of barriers in securing employment, with many asserting racism and discrimination at interview stage. And once a job's secured, workplace culture can provide a negative employment experiences for many. This shows a profound failure of employer equalities practice and can result in a lack of confidence among BAME women employees and complaints handling mechanisms, all resulting in racism, discrimination and inequality going unchallenged. And while employers on both the public and private sectors may be meeting their legal duties by having policies in place to challenge discrimination and inequalities, these policies have to be underpinned by training and support, which gives employees the tools to report unacceptable behaviour, feel comfortable in doing so, and also importantly, that managers and other employees with HR responsibilities are equipped and comfortable to handle such complaints. I feel it's important to echo the report's suggestion to develop a toolkit which delivers race and ethnicity induction and training at work to foster inclusive workplace cultures. These must not just be limited to the recruitment process. The Scottish Government's Workplace Equality Fund, which aims to work with businesses to address long-standing barriers in the labour market, is a welcome commitment and goes some way to challenging some of the issues. Scotland can and must tackle institutional racism, but we first must accept that it exists, whether it's explicit or indirect. Chief executives and business leaders have a responsibility to create and sustain workplaces where progress can flourish and diversity is valued for all the benefits it brings. We should all continue to work the work to ensure they do just that. Strong leadership, like that shown by the Young Women Lead Committee, is required to make employment of minority ethnic people a priority within organisations and business. Thank you, Presiding Officer.
Thank you very much. I now call Rachel Hamilton to be followed by Polly McNeill.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I firstly want to thank Linda Fabiani for bringing this members' debate to the Chamber today. And we know since 2017, the Young Women Lead Committee have been working so hard to ensure that young women from BAME backgrounds are better represented in all aspects of Scottish life. And it's unsurprising that Linda Fabiani, who convenes the group, described the young women involved as determined, dedicated and inspirational. I was deeply encouraged by their work, and I believe across Scotland, young people are rightly looking ahead positively despite the difficult times that we face. Young people, whether in the YWL committee or elsewhere, are working really hard to drive forward policies that will shape their futures, and it's crucial to the success of our future societal and monetary economy, especially for those from BAME backgrounds. It is indeed disappointing that in this day and age, we have to look at supporting specific ethnic groups rather than treating young people as a whole, where race, colour and ethnicity is colourblind. In Scotland, we have come a long way in promoting equality and equal opportunity, but a stark reality remains. Today, someone from a black and minority ethnic background is around twice as likely to experience poverty as someone from a white Scots-British background. And that chimes with the chosen topic of the inquiry this year, which was the transition from education to employment for young women from ethnic minorities. Without a doubt, this year has been the most difficult year of recent times for young people leaving school or university and finding employment. The COVID-19 pandemic has left many young people without the same chances to gain work experience for transitioning out of education. And despite BAME pupils performing very well at school or university, the report highlights young BAME women having to navigate the transition from education to employment with the added burdens of unconscious bias, stereotyping, gender and cultural ignorance. Research from the Centre for Racial Equality and Rights found that graduate unemployment is affecting BME graduates in Scotland, and they are up to three times more likely to be unemployed compared to white graduates. The impact of COVID is making the job market fiercely competitive this year, but without a doubt, these effects are far more pronounced for those with BAME backgrounds in the form of the ethnicity-related employment gap. Again, according to the Centre for Racial Equality and Rights, the gap in Scotland is much wider for younger people. For 16 to 24-year-olds, there is a 26.1% gap between minority ethnic and white employment rates. And for 25 to 34-year-olds, it stands at 25.3%. More action must be taken, not only reduce unemployment in the years of recovery ahead, but to tackle the deep and systemic racial problems which cause such gaps to prevail. Presiding Officer, I want to touch on some of the recommendations highlighted in this year's report, as I believe, if implemented fully, they could bring real and positive change in a future economic recovery. It's important that when we create new jobs, we ensure that there is an equal access to them, as well as the right support in workplaces for BAME people. Scottish Government should support the creation of BAME networks in different industries to aid mentorship and recruitment. And this would be the first step in ensuring that young BAME women can have an insight into what roles are out there and for people to mentor them with applications and interviews. And we need to see better links with BAME representatives in schools, colleges and universities, as well as in companies from a variety of sectors and indeed here in the Scottish Parliament. As covered by Ms. Fabiani, through a greater system of mentoring, career talks and specific BAME internships, young women can have more opportunities to add value work experience to their CV and equip them with the right tools to progress their careers. As we look to the future, I hope business and the government work constructively to remove the barriers for young BAME women. We seem to be repeating ourselves quite a lot in this parliament. We need to see real change. In conclusion, Presiding Officer, I want to thank the YWL committee and its convener, Linda Fabiani, for today's debate. I believe going forward, we must see more engagement from business and the Scottish Government in working collaboratively to mentor and train young BAME women so that they are provided with more opportunities when transitioning from education to employment. Thank you.
Thank you very much. I now call Pauline McNeill to be followed by John Finney.
Thank you, Presiding Officer, and thank you to Linda Fabiani for choosing this debate. There's no better person in my mind to lead such a group than Linda Fabiani, and her dedication to this issue, I'm sure, will stand the Parliament in good stead. I think we're all a bit jealous there, Linda, when you talked about all the places that you've been liaising with, Bavaria and Quebec, but of course we now know that you didn't leave your own living room to do that, but perhaps someday we'll get a chance to meet the people that have contributed to the report. So, a report which I wholeheartedly welcome and have been calling for some time myself for more data on not just Black, Asian, minority, ethnic women's experiences moving from education to employment, but but across the board on a whole host of issues. I note that Linda Fabiani said that the term BAME is not one which is liked, and there's been various terminologies we've used in the past. I think it's very important to listen to those women as to how we should continue to refer to them. But we know in Scotland that the number of BAME population women in leadership roles is very poor, particularly with respect to women. And they face unique barriers, as other members have talked about, as well as unconscious bias held by other people, which can limit their progression. So the remit of the report was to investigate what measures are being taken to increase employment opportunities for women from ethnic minorities, including recruitment, retention and development policies and practices. So one of the recommendations in the report was to ensure that local authorities promote BAME identifying individuals to senior positions in primary and secondary schools. Representation at the top of organisations and as early as possible is key to improving the systems in place. And it's vital that school leaders hire more diverse teachers. So many BAME students, particularly those from disadvantaged backgrounds, lack role models and mentors they can identify with and look up to in the classroom. It is the classic feature of inequality. And may I also explain why BAME students are less likely to get into the Russell Group of universities than their white British peers, despite having equivalent A-level results. So it may explain that. The report notes that the survey responses flagged up a lack of role models, with over a quarter of students said they had no role models, and with one respondent noting that most people who spoke to us were white men. It's quite staggering when you read that. And there is a severe lack of role models in high-ranked positions for BAME women in Scotland. There are no BAME women MSPs, been mentioned many times in many debates in this Parliament, and there have not been in the 20 years of devolution, unfortunately, a black mark on our Parliament's reputation, but hopefully can be corrected in the future. So having people look like yourself and understand your own experiences can hugely motivate people to pursue a similar career. So we have unconscious biases, they are learned stereotypes, they're automatic, unintentional, but deeply ingrained within our beliefs, and but have the ability to affect our behaviour, and they're a problem that we must address. Unconscious bias often prevents BAME women's progression in the workplace, and a survey conducted by Close the Gap found that over 70% of BAME women reported experiencing racism, discrimination, racial prejudice and or bias in the workplace. So it's clear, Presiding Officer, we have a great deal of work to do here, and we need to make sure this issue remains a high priority. We must make more serious progress in the next Parliament. And thanks again to Linda Fabiani for championing this important cause.
Thank you very much. And I call John Finney.
Thank you very much indeed, Presiding Officer. And can I join with others in congratulating Linda Fabiani, not just for securing this important debate, but also for our work that's brought us to the point where we can commend the Young Woman Lead Committee about their publication, and indeed all those who have been involved. Now, many of speeches about this important issue are peppered with statistics, and we often hear about the dearth of data, and of course that's an important issue, but I'm actually interested in attitudes. I know from my previous career in the police how sometimes statistics are abused and misused with fundamental misunderstandings historically about gender there. Now, there's no excuse nowadays with regard to the police service. But I'm also concerned that we can become focused on numbers and percentages. It must be about attitudes and it must be about real people. And as others have said, I think already, most fundamentally acknowledge a number of power imbalances, not least toxic male masculinity that peppers our society and therefore employment, the field of employment. A number of previous speakers have used the term unconscious bias and it undoubtedly exists. I fear it maybe lets some people off the hook, because quite evidently, self-evidently, we have very conscious bias, or bigotry, if we should call it that, discrimination. And perhaps, ironically, some of these debates are seen as perhaps a bit problematic because they're niche. It's equalities, it's rights, it's women, it's ethnic minorities. When, of course, what we need is a mainstreaming of the discussions that we're having at the moment. So BAME is perhaps a term that's not liked. I don't think folk are folk, but sometimes we have to group folk together. A term that's also used a lot is underrepresentation. I'd like to turn it in its head and talk about overrepresentation. And I'm from a group that's overrepresented, white middle-aged men, greatly overrepresented, and I've never encountered the glass ceilings that many of the contributors of that report have encountered. And it is to our shame that it's still the case. Hopefully will change in the very near future, that our own Parliament has not been blessed, and blessed we would be, by a more diverse representative of the group. So everything suggests that these young people have had restraints placed on their prospects, and education is a key. And it's, others have mentioned the recommendations, education recommendations in the report, and those are the ones that I think are important. Also want to touch on the Close the Gap research published in 2019, still not visible, the research there. I think we have to acknowledge the very sad truth with regard to BAME women, that it's highly likely they are visible. You can be seen, of course, and be ignored, and that's clearly happening. Your presence, indeed, could be used as evidence of a diverse workforce, window dressing in a more cynical way. So I found it very eliminating, the information that came out in that report, not least the level of racism experienced. And we know that if you've experienced racism, then all the other injustice, discrimination, prejudice, bias are going to flow from that. So we might think we're all jock tamsters, but we've a way to go with that with regard to racism and misogyny. I think there's a lot to be positive about. It may sound like I've been very negative. There's an awful lot to be positive about, not least the energy that has been the contributing factor to this report. Issues remain in workplaces. We know that. We know that procedures aren't great for resolving issues. As I say, the education section of this report is where I think we should focus. And from the motion, the report's recommendations to be considered in an effort to improve the outcomes for everyone affected, so as to create a fairer, better Scotland for all. Presiding officer, I very much hope that's the case, the very least we can do.
Thank you very much. And I now call on the Minister to conclude the debate, Minister Jamie Hepburn.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. They don't want to be known for being BAME. They want to be known for the person they are and for the skills that they have. Presiding Officer, those are words lifted directly from the Young Women Lead report we are discussing today. This quote highlights the importance of this issue. At the heart of what we discussed today, we must all ensure that we recognise the talents, celebrate their diversity, and utilise the unmatched skills that our young minority ethnic women have, and properly value their contribution in the workplace. Can I thank Young Women Lead, the Young Women's Movement, and of course Linda Fabiani for the excellent, thorough and very welcome report, and also thank Ms Fabiani for bringing forward this debate. The report highlights key challenges, as exemplified by the international engagement that Linda Fabiani and those involved in compiling the report have undertaken. They are not challenges, of course, unique to our country, but they are challenges that we must address with some urgency. Everyone should have the equal opportunities to gain fulfilling work that is fair, that develops their skills and talents, which values them, and of course properly rewards them. We know that the employment rate of the minority ethnic population in Scotland is lower than that of the white population. The latest data shows a minority ethnic employment rate gap of 13.1 percentage points. This gap is wider still between minority ethnic women and white women. There are a range of factors which, of course, contribute to this, and many have been alluded to today, but we know that minority ethnic women often face barriers that can hinder their career prospects because of the intersection of both their ethnicity and their gender, a point that Close the Gap, mentioned by Linda Fabiani, has made to me many times. The report makes a number of important recommendations in the areas of education and employment. In schools, the report rightly calls for more to be done to increase awareness of STEM-related subjects and increase uptake. That is why, through our STEM strategy, we are changing perceptions about STEM, challenging assumptions about who does what job. Education Scotland's dedicated gender balance and equality officers work with schools to tackle gender bias, to improve gender participation, and subject choice. Up to December of last year, they've engaged with 512 schools and held over 4,900 engagements with practitioners. The more widely we are refreshing our youth employment, developing a young workforce, a strategy to reflect the adverse effects of the COVID-19 pandemic in Scotland's young people, aiming to ensure that all young persons, young people, have equal access to all opportunities on offer. As part of this, we are rolling out DYW school coordinators who will provide support for young people from minority ethnic communities. We will work closely with Intercultural Youth Scotland so that their ambassadors can work with school coordinators to ensure that minority ethnic young people are supported in the choices they make. But representation in our schools is, of course, extremely important too. We are committed to doubling existing teacher numbers by 2030. We have pledged to champion diversity in Scotland's education system by developing bespoke mentoring and pathways for educators from minority ethnic backgrounds. On careers advice, we understand the importance of good quality and consistent advice to the development of young people's aspirations. As we make our way out of the pandemic, the importance of that advice will be crucial in giving young people the opportunities to develop their future careers. As Ruth Maguire highlighted, the report brings out some negative experiences that some young people have faced in accessing the careers advice. Whilst the report, of course, acknowledges some of the measures in place and progress made, one negative experience is one too many. I am committed to working with our partners, in particular Girls Development Scotland, to understand what further measures we can put in place to deliver our vision that everyone has access to world-class, professionally-led, aligned and flexible system of career support services which deliver for every citizen, regardless of where they live in Scotland, regardless of their age and regardless of their circumstance. In terms of employment, we have announced a range of measures to support those most disproportionately impacted by the pandemic. Our £60 million Young Persons Guarantee will benefit minority ethnic young people and it will be central to the design and implementation of the guarantee to ensure that the issues which matter to them are properly reflected in the work we take forward. We are working with organisations such as Intercultural Youth Scotland to ensure young people are meaningfully engaged as we implement the guarantee. I am determined we do more to understand and address the multiple barriers young minority ethnic women face, coupled at times with the discrimination, whether that be unconscious or indeed overt. And that's why we, as we review, are developing the Young Workforce Programme. We implement a Young Persons Guarantee and various other activities across government. We will reflect the voice of those who we want to benefit from the work that we are undertaking. And in that regard, I can let Ms. Fabiani and members know that my officials from the Young Persons Guarantee Division in the Scottish Government have contacted the Young Women's Movement to set up a meeting to discuss this report and how it might affect and inform the Young Persons Guarantee. Officer, more widely, our Workplace Equality Fund continues to support a range of organisations to become more diverse. In 2019-20, to the tune of £800,000, we funded 25 projects, 13 of them providing targeted support to minority ethnic people. The one particular project, led by an adopting intern, involved job-seeking black and minority ethnic women speaking to companies that they could hear firsthand the barriers to work faced by this group. And more recently, our Minority Ethnic Recruitment Toolkit, published in September, will give advice on the importance of use of workforce data to help determine approaches for recruitment campaigns. And this will help employers create more diverse workplaces that are properly reflective of the communities they serve. And these actions are designed to make a difference, but I'm clear that we must go further still. That's why we have outlined a range of commitments that we will be taking forward in response to the Equality and Human Rights Committee's inquiry findings on race equality, employment and skills. And can I also thank Ruth Maguire and her colleagues on the committee for the work they undertook in that inquiry. If we truly want a diverse Scotland, one that realises all the talents of all of our people, then it falls not just in government, but it must be a cross societal effort to make that difference we so desperately need to see. Presiding Officer, to return to Linda Fabiani's point, I don't intend that we just tick boxes, but that we open doors and effect real change. I will continue to listen and work with partners, and collectively we can and we will ensure Scotland is a fair nation for each and every Scotland's citizens.